بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Brothers and sisters in Islam, welcome to the second day of our stories of the Quran. Alhamdulillah, in this beautiful Ramadan, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it a blessed day of remembrance, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefit us with what we have to learn from tafsir today. Inshallah, we're going to carry on the story of Surah Sad, walhamdulillah, which is surah, a beautiful surah in the Quran, walhamdulillah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell us the story of 9 prophets of God. And inshallah, we're about to start with one of the prophets of God that we're going to talk about now, and that is the first one, which is Dawud alayhi salam. And there's one thing I want to tell you about before I get started about the story of Dawud alayhi salam. That is that Dawud alayhi salam was a very exemplary prophet of God, very exemplary human being. The Prophet ﷺ said the best ibadah was the ibadah of Dawud, meaning that Dawud alayhi salam, when it came to any act of ibadah, whether it be fasting, whether it be recitation of the Quran, whether it be salah, he prayed in the way that, you know, that you're meant to do it. You know, he fasted the way you're meant to fast. He prayed the way, you know, an exemplary human being, the best way of prayer. When he read the Quran, he read it in the best of ways, so much so that all of the animals would come and congregate together in order to listen to him. Such was Dawud alayhi salam. He was from the Banu Israel, and he was not a prophet of, he was not initially a king, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him a prophet king. And Allah Azzawajal gave him power, Allah gave him wealth, Allah gave him lots of wives, gave him lots of children. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him dominion in this dunya, and alhamdulillah, also in the akhirah. So here, Allah Azzawajal is going to tell us a story that happened with Dawud alayhi salam. And then after that, straight after, Allah is going to tell us a story of Sulaiman, of what happened with Sulaiman, and one incident in which Sulaiman gain prominence, and how Sulaiman made that amazing dua to Allah Azza wa Jal, "Oh Allah, give me power over something which no one has been given authority and power over." And so that's coming up, inshallah ta'ala. Today we have the story of Dawud, and this story of Dawud is a story of repentance. And I think the best way would be if I take the tafsir, actually, instead of giving you the story, right? If I take the tafsir as Allah says it, and then tell you the story as it develops, then inshallah it will actually have more meaning, inshallah. Shall we do it that way? Inshallah, a little bit of a divergent from how I've done before. I've given you a summary before, then I've told you. But this time I'm not going to tell you the story. I want you to, you know, listen to me and follow through with the Quran and be very amazed and impressed at how Allah tells us a story of one of the best slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how he gave haqq to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as Allah deserves to be given haqq to. Wasbir ala ma yaqulun. Yeah, Allah says the first thing he says in Surah Sa'd, verse number 17, Allah says, wasbir, meaning be patient, ala ma yaqulun, about what they say. Wadhkur abdana, and remember our slave, meaning one of the best ways to have sabr is to remember other people who are also tested like you. Yeah, and in our situation, we should remember Rasulullah, or we should remember someone else from the prophets of God that had similar tests and they had sabr, so that we may learn from how they have behaved and we may also behave in the same way. So Allah says to the Prophet of God, Muhammad, isbir, be patient, O Muhammad, ala ma yaqulun, wadhkur abdana Dawud, and remember our slave Dawud. Dhal aidi, the possessor of power, meaning remember our slave Dawud alayhi salam, the one who had so much power and ability that though, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you're a prophet and you're a messenger, Dawud alayhi salam was a king who had wealth, he had status, he had power, he had anything and everything he wanted in this dunya, yet he submitted to me with a full submission and he was patient in my worship. So remember my slave Dawud, the al-aidi, the possessor of strength and power, innahu awwab. He used to repent back to me, turn back to me. Awwab is the person who returns back. So ab means to return back in repentance and to come back to Allah Azza wa Jal. Therefore, awwab is the person who constantly returns back in repentance and turns back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah calls him innahu awwab. Then he says, inna sakharna al-jibal. We made the mountains turn towards him and sing praises with him. Inna sakharna al-jibala ma'ahu. We made the mountains sing praises with him. Yusabbihna bil-ashiyyi wal-ishraq. When he used to make dhikr and praise me in the morning and in the evening. So in the morning and in the evening, when these people, when Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam used to remember Allah azza wa jal and used to say the dhikr and the praises of Allah azza wa jal, he would make the mountains, Allah azza wa jal in his great glory, would make the mountains reverberate with sound, right? With the same dhikr of Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam, as if the mountains were singing praises of God along with Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam. So إِنَّ سَخَّرْنَا الْجِبَالَ مَعَهُ يُسَبِّحْنَا بِالْعَشِيِّ وَالْإِشْرَاقِ. When he was to praise me in the عَشِي وَالْإِشْرَاقِ. So إِشْرَاقِ is a time of setting. عَشِي is a time of the setting of the sun. إِشْرَاقِ, the time of شُرُوق, which is the rising of the sun. And that is the time to praise Allah Azza wa Jal. After your Fajr prayer, after your Asr prayer, remember Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. That's when Allah Azza wa Jal loves to be remembered. وَالطَّيُّرَ مَحْشُورًا. And all of the birds would gather together to listen to Dawood. Can you imagine how beautiful and how perfectly he would recite the Zabur? And as a result of which, or even the birds that would all congregate together to listen to him. وَالطَّيُّرَ مَحْشُورَةً كُلٌّ لَهُ أَوَّابٌ. Every single thing would turn towards him when Dawood would recite the Zabur. How amazing is that? Can you imagine? I mean, I'm just trying to imagine how, you know, Dawood would be reciting and the birds and the animals. Yani, subhanAllah, yani, how amazing was that? But this is how beautiful the recitation of Dawood was. So Allah tells us this so that we may also give perfect, the haqq of the Qur'an. Yeah, we have to give the haqq of the Qur'an. So when you recite the Qur'an, it has to be done well. In a beautiful dress, in your best dress, in wudu, facing the qibla, remembering Allah is in front of you, and struggling to beautify the Quran. And don't say, oh, only Mishari can recite and only Mahar Mu'aqili can recite. No. Even you can recite beautifully as well. And you concentrate on reciting the Quran beautifully and giving it its haqq. The same thing when you pray, you know, remember that Allah is in front of you, Jannah to your right, Jahannam to your left, the Sirat under your feet. Remember the angel of death behind you. Remember in front of you is your grave. And with that attentiveness, then you pray. Can you imagine how beautiful your salah will be at that point? So, وَالطَّيُرَ مَحْشُورَةً كُلٌّ لَهُ أَوَّابٌ وَشَدَدَنَا مُلْكَهُ. And we strengthened his dominion and kingdom. وَآتَيْنَاهُ. And we gave him al-hikmah, which is wisdom. What is the wisdom? This is the prophethood. Yeah, that is called wisdom. وَآتَيْنَاهُ الْحِكْمَةَ وَفَصْلَ الْخِطَابِ. What is fasl al-khitab? Fasl al-khitab is the ability to judge between human beings and to give the most balanced and just view that does not either harm nor overly benefit one human being over another. Yeah, that's called fasl al-khitab, which is the just statement in between all of the opinions. So the most middle path, the most just judgment, that is what fasl al-khitab means. So Allah Azza wa Jal gave him dominion because of this. Yeah, because of his praising Allah, Allah gave him dominion. Because of him praising Allah, Allah gave him hikmah. Because of him praising Allah, Allah gave him fasl al-khitab. Ikhwani, these are things we all desire. We all want to speak the most upright speech. We want to have kingdom and dunya and this and power and wealth and authority in this dunya. And we want to have hikmah and wisdom. Yeah, we don't want to be a wealthy person who is an idiot. We want to be a wealthy person that's also smart. You can have all of this if you make dhikr of Allah Azza wa Jal, just like Dawood alayhi salam used to do bil ashiyyi wal ishraq. Wahal ataka naba'ul khasam. Now Allah Azza wa Jal is going to tell you one particular incident that happened in the story of Dawood alayhi salam. So Dawood was one day he was with his companions. And one of the companions said to Dawood alayhi salam, saying, Dawood, is it possible for a human being to never sin? Is it possible for a human being to never ever forgo one day even at least without sinning? Dawood said, yes, inshallah, it's possible. And I am that person. I can go a single day without sinning. So Allah wanted to test him, to prove him wrong. Yeah, Allah Azza wa Jalla wanted to teach his prophet and wanted to prove him wrong. So Allah wanted to test him and teach him. So Dawood woke up one day and said, today is that day where I'm not going to be sinning at all. And his strategy was that if he was reading the Zabur the whole day, he would find no time to sin, right? Because he's reading, he's engaged in some good deed. Where would you find the time to sin? So what happened was, Dawood alayhi salam on that day, he sat down and he started reciting the Zabur. And when he recited the Zabur, the birds would come and congregate, as you know. So this beautiful bird came. It was reported in the tafsir that this very beautiful bird came, and Dawood was distracted whilst reciting the Zabur, distracted by the beauty of this bird. And when he saw the bird in that direction, he also saw a woman who was in her house. And when he saw that woman, he desired her. He later on continued, of course, after that, you know, one glance, then he went back to his reading, finished the whole Zabur the whole day, and alhamdulillah, he thought that no sin had he done that day. But then Allah tested him because of what happened in his heart, and he liked that girl. He tried to find out about who that girl is. So later on, he found out that that girl was written to be married to a particular man. And when he found out about that, then Dawood alayhi salam, as in the tafsir, he sent that man off to different battles. And before that man could go off to different battles, this story happened. So Allah Azza wa Jal taught him a lesson. What was the lesson Allah taught him? So listen to the story, because through the story, Allah Azza wa Jal gave hikmah to Dawood. And you know, this is why, you know, people who are hakim, people who are knowledgeable and have wisdom, you know, they ponder on everything that happens around you. That's who an awwab really is. An awwab is a person who ponders on every situation that Allah sends to him, whether it be a bit of hunger that Allah gives him, then he thinks, you know, subhanallah, Allah is teaching me the value of feeding people. I should feed people food, you know. And then he goes out and he feeds people food because he took that hunger, that pang of hunger he felt from that one day of fasting, as a lesson for him that he should also remember those people who go through this every day. Or for example, his children misbehave with him one day. So a person thinks, you know, subhanallah, my children misbehave with me today. It must be because my parents are angry with me. So then he goes home and then he's, you know, better to his parents. That is a person who ponders. Yeah, and that is how Dawood was, is that he pondered in every single situation that Allah sent him, because he knew that every single situation was a lesson and a test. Do we do this, brothers and sisters? Do we really ponder on every situation that we go through? And do we take lessons from it? We should be doing so. Because you know what? Every single opportunity is an opportunity for a lesson. And we should be learning from every circumstance. So Dawood learned from this lesson. What was the lesson? وَهَلْ أَتَاكَ النَّبَأُ الْخَصَمُ. And has the story of the two people who were debating each other come to you? إِذْ تَصَوَّرُ الْمِحْرَابُ. When they jumped over the walls, meaning they jumped over the wall of Dawood alayhi salam to get into his palace. And this is amazing because Dawood, one of the things that Dawood thought that he had alayhi salam was that he thought he was mighty. He was powerful. He had protection. So if these two people were able to jump over the wall and get into the palace of Dawood to gain an entrance, what sort of protection did he have really? You know what I'm saying? So Allah Azza wa Jal already is teaching him that, you know what, no one can protect you except Allah Azza wa Jal. Okay? So these two people jumped over the mihrab. إِذْ دَخَلُوا عَلَى دَاوُودِ. When they entered upon Dawood, فَفَزِعَ مِنْهُمْ. So Dawood became shocked. Why did he become shocked? Because like, who let you in? Where did you come from? Oh, sorry Dawood, we just jumped over the fence. So just to show you, you know, sometimes like, just to show you how you think that you are safe and protected, but Allah shows you that it is always Allah protecting you, and all of your walls and your guards can never ever protect you from Allah Azza wa Jal. فَفَزِعَ مِنْهُمْ. So he became a bit shocked with them. So the two of them said, قَالُوا لَا تَخَفْ. Don't be worried. Sorry Dawood, I'm sorry, I know we came without permission, But don't be afraid. لا تخاف, they said. خصمان, we are two people who are having a problem, a debate. So please, we need you to judge between us. خصماني, بغى بعضنا على بعض. So one of them said, we are two people who are having a debate and an argument. One of us has taken advantage of the other one. بغى بعضنا على بعض, has taken advantage of the other one. فحكم بيننا بالحق. So please judge between us in truth. ولا تشتق, and don't be uncertain. وَهْدِنَا إِلَىٰ سَوَاءِ الصِّرَاطِ, and please guide us, O Dawood, with your wisdom to the straight path. إِنَّ هَذَا, so one of them spoke up and said, إِنَّ هَذَا, O Dawood, this brother of mine, one of them spoke up and said, إِنَّ هَذَا أَخِي, he is my brother. Some of the scholars said that this was his brother from his own mother. إِنَّ هَذَا أَخِي, this is my brother. لَهُ تِسْعُ وَتِسْعُونَ نَعْجَ, he has 99 goats. Okay, he has 99 goats. وَلِيَ نَعْجَةٌ وَاحِدًا, I'm a miskin, I have only one goat. فَقَالَ أَكْفِلْنِيهَا وَعَزَّنِي فِي الْخِطَابِ. So what did he do? The guy with the 99 goats came to me, my brother came to me, and he made it out that he needed my goat. Right? He made it out that he needed my goat, that something happened to his other goats and he still is deficient and he needs one more to complete his full possession of 100. So he defeated me. This is the poor man, a poor of the two brothers, speaking on, saying that this brother of mine, my rich brother, defeated me with his words. Defeated me with his words, and he convinced me to give my goat to him so that he can have 100 and I can have 0. So, I mean, what do you say to these people? You know, sometimes you do empathize with people, you know. I mean, sometimes, you know, rich people are very good at convincing others, right? You know, like you go to your uncle and say, you know, uncle has a Mercedes Benz and he drives, he lives in, you know, Beverly Hills, and, you know, he's got $1 million mansion and he's got a $10 million business. So uncle, you know, please uncle, you know, I need to borrow some money, you know, I need to, you know, I put my kids through school. Can I have $10,000 loan? So, you know, uncle makes it out the other way. It's like, Wallah, Tawfiq, you know, what can I say? You know, Subhanallah, my business is going down. My wife is coming to me every day. And, you know, my partners need this. And I just invested in this. You know, the way they make it out, sometimes like, no, uncle, you know what? I'll give you money. Have you had uncles like that? You know, where they make it out like they are poorer than you are, you know, even though they are 100 times richer. They make it out like they're so poor and in such cash flow crisis, you feel like giving to them instead of the other way around. So this is what this man is saying, okay? My brother has 99 goats, right? And I have only one, but then he defeated me with his ability to speak. وَعَزَّنِي فَقَالَ أَكْفِلْنِيهَا. So he said, please give me your goat. وَعَزَّنِي بِالْخِطَابِ, and he defeated me with his statement. So please, O Dawood, will you please judge between us and saying, you know, what's the ruling? Qala. So did the other brother speak back? He didn't speak back. He just kept quiet, which means that he agreed to what was being said. So Dawood spoke out with his judgment. What did Dawood say? Qala. لَقَدْ ظَلَمَكَ بِسُؤَالِكَ. He has indeed wronged you, O poor man. He has, your brother, the rich one, has indeed wronged you. لَقَدْ ظَلَمَكَ بسؤالك, by asking you, نعجتك, your one goat, إلى نعاجه, towards his other goats. وإن كثيرا من الخلطاء, and verily a lot of people are like that, you know. كثيرا من الخلطاء لا يبغي بعضهم على بعض, and a lot of wealthy rich people, that's what they want. They just want to take advantage of one over the other, and that's how they get rich. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات, except for those who believe and do righteous deeds. وَقَلِيلٌ مَا هُمْ, and how few are they. So Dawood gave the judgment, and gave the judgment in favor of the poor person who had only one. And the other one said, I'm sorry, you know, go back to your 99 goats. You're getting only your 99. Don't ask for the one from this man. So he judged between them, returned the goat back to the guy with the one goat, and then they all went back home. So وَظَنَّ Dawood. Now Dawood began to think and ponder, and he said, Subhanallah, Subhanallah, I wanted that one woman just because of her beauty, and I already have so many women already, meaning I have so many wives. So Allah sent me those two people to test me. That's when you realize in Subhanallah, Ya Rab, that one day that I thought that I would not sin, I actually sinned. Can you imagine? And I sinned whilst I was doing the best of deeds, which is reading the Torah, reading the Zabur. You know, whilst doing the best of deeds, he sinned. And so he realized that how weak he is and how it is only by the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal that we will enter Jannah. So Allah says, وَظَنَّ دَاوُدُ أَنَّمَا فَتَنَّاهُ. So Dawood understood that we had tested him. فَاسْتَغْفَرَ رَبَّهُ. So he sought the repentance of his Lord. How did he repent to Allah? It was said in the tafsir that he prostrated towards the Qibla. He prostrated to Allah Azza wa Jal in his mihrab. For how long? For 40 days. For 40 days until they said that he was about to die from hunger. But for 40 days he was prostrating, not getting up from his sujood except to go and pray in the masjid and come back for his congregatory prayers. But then he prostrated to Allah Azza wa Jal for 40 days. فَاسْتَغْفَرَ رَبَّهُ وَخَرَّ رَاقِعًا وَأَنَابُ. And he continued to remain ruku'an, meaning sujoodan, right? In Quran, sujood and ruku' are used synonymously. So he was ruku'an, meaning that he was in prayer and sujood. وَأَنَابُ. And he repented to me. Ya Akhwani, Subhanallah. You know, sometimes a bad deed can lead you to Jannah. Yeah, and this is what's happened to Dawood here. One deed that he did, which he now is so repentant and penitent, look at how he repented. Had he not done that sin, perhaps he would not have repented to Allah in that manner. And look at the way he repented to Allah. How do we repent to Allah? Astaghfirullah, Ya Rab, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Okay, and then now move on. I mean, what is that? It's like a fly that just came, it's like, you know, and then the fly goes away. This is not how a sin is removed. A sin sticks with you. A sin has to be removed. You have to scratch. You have to remove. When you remove a dirt on your hand, it causes friction, pain. You've got to work at it. Tawbah can't just be done just like astaghfirullah, that's it. Forget, no. Tawbah has to be earned. You have to earn tawbah. And that's how Dawood alayhi salam, just to show you how he perfected every act. When he prayed perfectly. When he read Zabur, he read it perfectly. When he made tawbah, he made it perfectly. So he prostrated to Allah Azza wa Jal and he made repentance. And that's how we should also ask Allah for tawbah. So if we have done a heinous crime, brothers and sisters, then let's make tawbah in that manner. There's also one more thing I want to tell you before I move on. And that is what Al-Ghazali rahimahullah says in Ihya Ulumuddin. Al-Ghazali said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes gives slaves sins rather than giving him good deeds. Why? Because through that sin, Allah humbles him and he realizes his ability is so low and his ability to, or his preponderance towards sin is so high, that because of which he feels so much regret and shame in front of Allah, for which because of this Allah raises him up in levels and gives him more ajr, more reward than it would have been possible had this guy continued to only do good deeds. And this is the wisdom behind human beings sinning, that through this Allah lowers a person and humbles him, which then elevates him in the akhirah and gives him a greater status. And this is why, my brothers in Islam, whoever humbles himself for Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah will raise him up. So humble yourself, consider yourself nothing in front of Allah. And that's why it was reported in authentic hadith in Musnad Imam Ahmad that one of the Sahaba came to the masjid and Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu ta'ala was making dua. So this Sahaba said, Salaam alaikum, Ya Uthman. So Uthman continued making dua. So this Sahaba became worried and he went to Umar and said, what's happened to Uthman? Doesn't he return my salam anymore? Is he not Muslim? And look how the issue of giving salam was so important. And so they went back to Uthman and said, Uthman, what's wrong with you? He said, oh, I didn't even realize you gave me salam. I'm so sorry. I was so busy thinking about something and making dua to Allah. So what happened? He said, I have this musibah that has come in my life and I was making dua to Allah to remove it. You know, sometimes that happens, right? When you have this musibah in your head and you're so absorbed and then you make dua to Allah, oh Allah, remove it. And because of that being absorbed in that musibah, you forget even sometimes who's saying salam to you, who's speaking to you, you don't even hear sometimes. Happens, right? So they went to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, shall I teach you? Listen to this, because such a beautiful dua, and you should remember this. He said, shall I teach you a dua which if you say, then Allah will accept every supplication that you make? And this is what we want, right? We want Allah to accept every supplication. So the Sahaba said, yes, Ya Rasulullah, teach us. What is the dua? What can we say to Allah in our dua that will make Him accept everything that we tell Him? So he said, say the dua of Yunus in the belly of the whale. What was the dua of Yunus in the belly of the whale? La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. Right? That's the dua. Fanada an la ilaha illa anta subhanak inni kuntu min al-zalimin. This is the dua, ya akhwani. Because in this dua, first you have said, la ilaha illa anta. There is no deity worthy of worship except you. Subhanak. You've raised Allah up. Inni kuntu min al-zalimin. I am the lowest of the low. I am the one who's wronged myself. Oh Allah, you are the highest. So when you have done this, when you have lowered yourself to the soul, lowest of the low, and you have raised Allah to the highest of the high, that is what Allah answers a dua. And this is why Ibn al-Qayyim says in al-Wabil al-Sayyib, right? Al-Kalimat al-Tayyib, he says, that is the power of Sayyid al-Istighfar. The dua called Sayyid al-Istighfar. Why is it Sayyid al-Istighfar? What is the dua of Sayyid al-Istighfar, or the leader of Istighfar? Best way to make Istighfar, the prince of the du'as of Istighfar. Do you know what it is? It's called Sayyid al-Istighfar. You can type it in Google, you can check it in Hisn al-Muslim, you can find this dua, Sayyid al-Istighfar. Listen to the dua and it will show you why this dua is like the repentance of Dawood. So what is this dua? Allahumma, O our Lord, Anta Rabbi, you are my Lord, Khalaqtani, you created me, right? وَأَنَا عَلَىٰ عَهْدِكَ وَوَعْدِكَ مَسْتَطَعْتِ. And I am upon your promise as much as I'm able to do so. أَعُوذُ بِكَ مِن شَرِّ مَا صَنَعَتْ. I seek refuge in you, O Allah, from what I have done, what filth I have done. وَأَبُوءُ لَكَ بِنِعْمَتِكَ عَلَيَّ. And I acknowledge your great blessings upon me. وَأَبُوءُ لَكَ بِذَنْبِي. And I acknowledge, O Allah, my lowly being, how much sins I have done. ذَنْبِي, my sin. فَغْفِرْ لِي. So forgive me. إِنَّهُ لَا يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبِ إِلَّا أَنْتَ. No one can forgive sins except you. So in this dua, what have we done? Raised Allah up, we put ourselves down. Raised Allah up. You created me, you blessed me, you gave me this. Me, I am the one who sins. I am the one who's done this. I am the filthy human being who's done this. When you speak like this, that is when Allah envelops you with mercy. That is when Allah knows that my slave knows who I am, and he knows who he is. For him will be goodness in this dunya, and for him is to be a prince in the akhirah. This, ya akhwani, is the way to make dua. Yeah? La ilaha illa anta subhanak inni kuntu min al-zalimin. And this is what he is doing here. He is raising Allah up and he is putting himself down. And with that, alhamdulillah, he is achieving the true status of istighfar. Look what Allah says. فَغَفَرْنَا لَهُ ذَلِكَ. So we forgave him for that. We forgave Dawood alayhi wasallam for that mistake. So what a beautiful thing, isn't it? To get Allah's repentance means Allah forgives, subhanAllah. So فَغَفَرْنَا لَهُ ذَلِكَ. وَإِنَّ لَهُ, and for him with us, عِنْدَنَا with us, لَزُلْفَى, will be a beautiful end, وَحُسْنَ مَآبَ, and a beautiful, beautiful dwelling. So, Ikhwani, can you see how Allah forgave him and gave him لَزُلْفَى وَحُسْنَ مَآبَ, king, prophet, king in this dunya and from the princes of Jannah. Can you imagine how Dawood has been blessed because of his repentance? So if we want this as well, then we must repent to Allah like this. But look at the very next verse. What does Allah say? Allah calls out Dawood after his repentance. Says, Ya Dawood, O Dawood, Inna ja'alnaka, verily we have made you khalifatan fil ard. We have made you a khalifa on this earth. Meaning, look at how Allah has rewarded the repentance of Dawood by giving him a massive reward in return. What was the reward in return? That Allah had not only made him the king in this dunya, but made him a khalifa to discharge the affairs of this dunya on behalf of Allah Azza wa Jal. Ya Dawud, inna ja'alnaka khalifatan fil ard, fahkum bayna an-nas bil haqq. So judge between mankind with truth. Wala tattabi' al hawa, and do not follow misguidance and your desires. Fayudillaka, it will misguide you an sabilillah, from the path of Allah. Innal ladhina yadhillun, verily those who are misguided an sabilillah, away from the path of Allah, lahum adhabun shadid, for them is a terrible torment. Bima nasu yawm al hisab, because of them forgetting the day of judgment. Wama khalaqna as-samaa'a wal ard, we have not created the heavens and the earth. Wama baynahuma, and that which is between them, batila, in playful jest. We didn't just say, you know what? Mountains there, sea there. No. It was all done due to a great wisdom. ذَلِكَ ظَنُّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, that is the thinking of those who are disbelievers. فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنَ النَّارِ, so woe to the disbelievers from the terrible Jahannam. أَمْ نَجْعَلُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, shall we make those who have believed, وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, and done righteous deeds, كَالْمُفْسِدِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ, like those who spread mischief in the land. أَمْ نَجْعَلُ الْمُتَّقِينَ كَالْفُجَّارِ, do you expect me to treat the muttaqeen, those who fear me, like the ones who are fujjar, those who are transgressors, those who spread mischief in the land, those who disobey me? Meaning, why do you expect me, O people? And this is in reference to those guys, the Quraysh, that had congregated with Abu Talib at that time, and they were saying, why has Muhammad Sassim been chosen as a messenger? So Allah is saying here, can't you see? Shall I put the muttaqeen with the fujjar? Shall I put those who have believed and done righteous deeds with those who have spread mischief on this land? What is wrong with you? How do you judge? Abu Jahl and Rasulullah Sassim can't ever be the same. Abu Lahab and Abu Bakr can never be the same. They are not two human beings of the same type. One feared Allah, the other one didn't. One spread mischief in the land, the other one spread goodness in the land. How do you expect me to treat both of them the same? And that is why, how do you expect me to choose you, O Abu Jahl, who is a filthy human being, as a prophet of God, when whilst leaving aside an excellent human being like Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So, أَمْ نَجْعَلُ مُتَّقِينَ كَالْفُجَّارِ, shall we put the muttaqeen like fujjar? Kitabun, all of this is in a book, which is in the Quran. Anzalnahu ilayk, we have revealed this book to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Mubarakun, it is blessed book. Yeah, can you see how blessed this one page we take in the tafsir is? So amazing. Mubarakun liyadabbaru ayatihi, let them ponder on its sides. And this is what we're doing now. We're pondering on the Quran. So we're doing exactly what Allah Azza wa Jal asked us to do. لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ, we reveal this book, it's blessed, so that they may ponder on its meanings, on its signs. وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ, and so that it may be a remembrance for those people who have sense and logic. With that, alhamdulillah, we're going to stop here inshallah, if Allah wills. We're going to stop here and we're going to come back tomorrow to the story of Sulaiman alayhi salam and the story of Shu'aib and others, inshallah. And we will carry on the story of repentance, the story of sabr and patience of the prophets of God, and how that carries a lesson for us, inshallah ta'ala. Zakumullah khair to all my brothers and sisters. I hope you benefited from today. Please remember the worship of Dawood, the repentance of Dawood alayhi salam, and be of those people, alhamdulillah, who repent to Allah Azza wa Jal and who worship Allah Azza wa Jal like that. And you know, subhanAllah, after reading the story of Dawood, you know, I feel like asking my wife, you know, have another son, one son, let's call him Dawood. You know, because subhanAllah, such an excellent human being, and what an excellent prophet, and what an excellent Quran that teaches us the story of such excellent human being. Jazakumullah khair. Inshallah, until tomorrow. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.